Hello folks, and thank you for joining me. I'm trying to get prepared here for today's reading, or one, or this reading, whatever. Actually, I'm going to do a couple today. And these will be new readings, again, I was going to go by my list, and I got down here, and I thought, no, I'm going to go with this one, because it kind of goes with the other two I just posted up. So, this one is The Meaning of Masonry, a lecture read at the request of the Grand Lodge of Louisiana by Brother Albert Pike. The evil consequences of schisms and disputes for power in Masonry, and the jealousies and dissensions between Masonic rites, 1858. Such, my brethren, is the subject on which I have been requested to address you. Some who have the interest of Masonry at heart have thought it was possible to say something upon this subject that might tend to remove erroneous impressions, to increase union and harmony among Masons, and to persuade society at large that its well-being and progress are to some extent involved in the advancement and prosperity of Masonry. They have demanded that I should say that something, and though unaffectedly reluctant to do it, my obligation as a Mason bars against me all the avenues of escape, and compels disinclination, to yield to the imperative mandate of duty. I would need no argument to show that the Masonic order itself, as to any other order or association, however unpretending and unimportant, intestine dissensions, struggles for possession of power, jealousies and heart burnings, must necessarily be harmful, retard its growth and progress, repel those who, if it were at peace with itself, would seek to approach its doors, and at first diminish and ultimately destroy its capacity for usefulness. If this were all that I desire to establish, I might say so much, and at once conclude. But we, my brethren, do not believe that it is all, that this is all. We think that the highest interests of society and of the community in which we live, and perhaps even interests wider and more general still, those of a nation and of a humanity at large, are affected and injured in that which affects and does harm to Masonry. We think that the world without our temples is deeply interested in the continuance or restoration of peace and harmony within, and that every Mason who encourages or by apathy permits dissensions within the walls that veil our mysteries from the world's eyes is an enemy not of Masonry only, but of that world's advancement and prosperity. It is indeed, they've self-appointed themselves the savior of the world and man. Thus is why they're into everything. It is indeed true that the world at large, the statesmen and the men of business, are not in the habit of attaching much importance to the peaceful operations, the active efforts and the silent influences of Masonry. Some even think evil of the order. To others, its pretensions are the subject of mirth and food for ridicule, while probably the general impression is that it is a harmless and inoffensive association, rather laudable for its benevolent propensities, its charities, and its assistance its members mutually lend each other. But one in which the world at large is in no wise interested, one whose ceremonies are frivolous, its secrets mere pretense, its titles and dignities absurd, and its dissensions mere childish disputes for barren honors and empty precedency, fit only to excite the pitying smiles of the grave and the sarcastic laughter of the ill-natured. Nor is it to be denied that there is some warrant for this, and it says sime, but it's supposed to say some warrant for this in the unfortunate proclivity of overzealous and in judicious, brethren, to make the history of Masonry remount to the time when Adam, in the Garden of Eden, was Grand Master, to invent fables and manufacture traditions, to invest with a mysterious sanctity the trite commonplaces that all the world is at liberty to know, to give interpretations of symbols that every scholar knows to be untrue and every man of sense knows to be vapid and trivial, in the vain parade of sounding titles and the glittering decorations, and more than all, in the angry disputes which rend the bosom of order of the order, accompanied with bitter words, harsh epithets, and loud denunciations that give the lie to the combatants' claim of brotherhood in regard to questions that to the world seem trifling and unreal. And I'll tell you what's trifling and unreal is how long-winded Pike is. You see it here. It's just these words that just to use words. Is society really interested in the peace and progress of Masonry? As the world, a moral right to demand that harmony shall govern in our temples? Is that a matter which at all concerns the community? How grave and important are the interests that by our mad dissensions we recklessly put at hazard? And by what means are peace and harmony to be restored and maintained? Such are the questions which it is demanded of me to consider. To do so, it is evidently necessary first to settle what Masonry is, and what its objects are, and by what means and appliances it proposes to effect those objects. The well-being of any nation, like that of every individual, is threefold: physical, moral, and intellectual. Neither physically, morally, or intellectually is a people ever stationary. Always it either advances or retrogrades, and as when one climbs a hill of ice, to advance requires continual effort and exertion, while to slide downward one needs but to halt. The happiness and prosperity of a people consist in advancing on each of the three lines, physical, moral, and intellectual, at once, for the day of its downfall draws nearer even when its intellect is more developed and the works of its genius are more illustrious. No. And while its physical comforts increase, if its moral progress does not keep pace with its physical and intellectual, and yet without the last, the two first do not mark the loftiest condition of a great people. That institution deserves the title of public benefactor, which by a system of judicious charities and mutual assistance diminishes the sum total of haggard want and destitution, and relieves the public of a portion of a burden which the necessities of the poor and shelterless impose upon it, for it thus aids the physical advancement of the people. It still more deserves the title if, in addition, it imperatively requires of its members the strict and faithful performance of all those duties towards their fellow men as individuals which the loftiest and purest morality enjoins. And so is the potent auxiliary of the laws, and the enforcer of the moral precepts of the great teacher who preached the Sermon on the Mount, for thus it labors for the moral evaluation of the people. And still more, if its initiates are also and of necessity devoted to the true interests of the people, if they are a soldiery of liberty and equality and brotherhood, and at the same time of good government, good order, and of the laws, that made by the representatives of all, for the general good of all, must be implicitly obeyed by all, for thus again it aids in elevating still higher the moral character of the people. And most of all, in addition to all this, it strives to elevate the people intellectually by teaching those who enter its portals in the profoundest truths of philosophy and the wisdom of the sages of every age a rational conception of the deity, of the universe that he has made, and of the laws that govern it. A true estimate of man himself, of his freedom to act, of his dignity and his destiny. I mean to speak only of what Masonry teaches, and to set up no extravagant pretensions on its behalf. And to set up no extravagant pretensions on its behalf, that its precepts are not fully obeyed by its initiates in no wise detracts from their value or excellence, any more than the imperfect performance of its votaries detracts from the excellence of religion. The theory and the intentions of every man that lives are better and purer than his practice. I do not say that they are unfortunately so, for it is one of the great kindnesses of Providence and the most conclusive proof of God's existence and infinite benevolence, that the worst as well as the purest of men has ever which he must perforce always struggle to reach. An idea, an exemplar of a rarer excellence than he can ever attain to. Strive and struggle as he may, it has been well and truly said that even hypocrisy is the involuntary homage which vice pays to virtue. Okay, and this is a very true statement right here. I want to add that, I mean, that is, if you notice in human nature, we chase things until we catch them. Whether it's chasing women, chasing money, chasing cars, that whatever it is you chase, it's humans have this nature thing that's, it's in the chase, the excitement, it's just like this journey we're on right now of life. It's not a destination. The point is not the destination. It's the journey itself. And this is proven time and again in our nature by this very means he talks about. And so we set a standard that is something that we cannot ever attain. And that way we keep trying to attain it. Because if he was to attain it, just like if you get the girl or get the car, then what do? You're on to the next thing, right? Because you got that, you stick it in the garage or whatever, you know. And so I just wanted to point that out. That was a very good statement on his behalf in this part. So that Masons do not live up to the teaching of their order proves only that they are men, that like other men they are weak with the frailties of feeble human nature, and that in the never-ceasing struggle with their passions and the mighty circumstances that environ us all, it is often their lot to be discomfited. If the doctrines of Masonry are good, they of necessity have their effect, and are never taught in vain. For not in vain are the winged seeds of truth ever sown, and if committed to the winds, God sees to it that they take root somewhere and grow. So, and, you know, although I poke a little fun at Pike's long-windedness, when he does get around to the points, his points are usually poignant. So, I thank you for joining me for this one, and we'll stack this on top of the other two I just posted. I think it fits in quite nicely.